In 2 Corinthians 7, Paul plainly explains to the believers of Corinth that the sorrow he provoked within them over their mistreatment of him and the message that he brought is a sorrow that can ultimately be for their good. I am convinced that a correct handling of sorrow in the face of guilt is what we so desperately need, so that we can abandon the charades that we have learned along the way to escape the things that bring change in our life. The Church of Corinth and the Apostle Paul have a tenuous and complicated history, but if you come to a little bit of understanding, you'll see just why this letter that Paul sent was so complicated for them to receive and for him to send. Of all the churches that Paul worked with, the Church of Corinth probably challenged him the most. They simply refused to make things easy for him. Corinth was the hub of economic and political and entertainment and religious activities. The church, as a result, was constantly at risk, as individuals or as a whole, of falling back into the culture that they have been redeemed out of. Many of the things that Paul addresses in his letters, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, have to deal with encroaching ideas and practices found within that nearby culture that they were living in. The 7-plus years of history that Paul shares with this church play out like some sort of staged reality TV show. You just can't even believe this is happening. How could believers be doing this? How could they think that of Paul? And so if we look into this drama just a little bit, we will begin to understand 2 Corinthians 7 and why Paul had to say these things. Paul's first visit was on his second missionary journey. He came to Corinth. There was no church there, and he helped to plant that church. He stayed there for a year and a half, and in that time is when he built that relationship with Aquila and Priscilla, two friends of his that would continue working with the churches that he planted. After that year and a half, he moved along, and actually Aquila and Priscilla came with him, and they eventually would stop in Ephesus. After he had been gone there for a little bit of time, he received a report of some moral compromise that was happening within the church. And so we learn in actually 1 Corinthians 5:9 that he wrote a letter to them at that time responding to the moral compromise that he had heard of. Like, hey, if this is true, you know, stop that. And so we read about that in 1 Corinthians 5:9. And their response to that first letter that Paul wrote to them was they sent him a letter with tons of questions. And so 1 Corinthians is the letter that Paul writes in response to all those questions that they wrote to him. And 1 Corinthians kind of came down on that church like a velvet-covered brick. They didn't like it, and as a result, they ended up not really liking Paul very much. And there was other things going on in the church at that time, but 1 Corinthians kind of started this quick decline with their relationship with Paul. And so after Paul hears of this decline happening within the Church of Corinth, he goes back for a second visit, and he terms this his painful visit. There he is openly challenged. Many people challenge whether he is really an apostle. They think of him as weak and kind of just pathetic to behold in person. They think his letters are a little more powerful than his own personal presence. And Paul does not leave that church after that second visit with a healthy heart. He was hurt. He had basically been forced out of town. They had said some things that had really just made him feel broken. And so after that second visit, Paul writes what he calls his tearful letter. And this is a letter in which he lays his heart bare. He calls them out for the sin that he sees in their life, for the way that they have treated the message and the messenger of God. And so this passage, 2 Corinthians 7, is Paul reflecting back on the result of that tearful letter. And so he writes 2 Corinthians upon hearing back from Titus what the result was as that letter, that tearful letter, hit the church. And then Paul would make one final visit to the church of Corinth as things were in much better place at that point. And as far as we can tell from what we can see within Scripture, we don't think that Paul ever made another visit to the Church of Corinth. And so that 7 years kind of surmises what their relationship was looking like, full of feelings, full of letters back and forth. And it's pretty incredible that things could go from so bad to so good over those years. 2 Corinthians 7, which we're going to be going over today, is Paul's fourth letter describing the result of his third letter, the tearful letter. So, hang with me here. While we know of four letters, we actually don't have the first and the third letter. We only have the second and the fourth letter, which are 1 and 2 Corinthians. The other letters are only referenced by those books of the Bible. And so in just Paul's history with the Corinthians, we see that the fact that confronting sin and calling God's people to repentance are the primary instruments of sanctification in the life of a Christian. That is how God can really grow people, is by having them acknowledge the sin that they are in and continually repenting to Christ and remembering the gospel. And so as we discover elsewhere in 2 Corinthians, the result of the tearful letter was a threefold division within the church. Paul sends this tearful letter. Titus takes this letter and gives it to the church, and he spends a matter of probably some months there with them. And what we see is kind of this threefold division that comes from this letter and just from what had been going on there. The first group are those that are in open rebellion to Paul and the message that he was bringing. They don't like him. They don't like his message. They probably didn't like Titus as a result. And so Paul, in some of his in 2 Corinthians, goes even so far to challenge their profession of faith. The second group, they are the fair weather fans. They are the fence sitters. They could go one way or the other, kind of like some of our duck or beaver fans here in the area. You know, if Paul's on their good side, yeah, that he's great. If he's saying something they don't like, no, we don't like him. And then group one is filled with the believers in the church that have remained faithful to Paul, or upon receiving these letters, have repented of the wrong that they have done and become loyal once again. This passage mainly addresses those in that third group, those who are now loyal to him, with the hope that some in the second group would see their actions and show some sorrow and repent, that they would be won over as well. And so Paul, in chapter 7, is interpreting his actions for them. He wants to show them that the sorrow that he caused by his letter was not for nothing, that sorrow can bring change leading to salvation. Paul begins by reminding them that they are his spiritual children. These Corinthians have a special place in his heart, and that he has done nothing that should have removed him from their heart. His purpose in clearing his name here, once again, is not so that he can heap judgment on them now that his name is clear, but rather like a good parent, he wants to remind them. He desires to correct them and not destroy them. Back earlier in the book of 2 Corinthians, in chapter 2, verse 4, Paul says, "For I wrote to you out of much affliction and anguish of heart, and with many tears, not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you." In chapter 7, Paul restates once again, "Make room for us in your heart. Make room in your heart for us. We have wronged no one. We have corrupted no one. We have taken advantage of no one." These were the challenges and the accusations leveled against him. And he is having to clear his name and remind them that we did none of those things that you think I did. "I do not say this," this is verse 3, "I do not say this to condemn you, for I said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together." They, in fact, despite the great pain they have caused him, are a reason for great joy and pride for Paul. This is a church that he saw spring out of a very sad, sad city. And so they, despite the ways that they treat him and the things they say against him, they mean something very important to him. And he describes this in verse 4. "I am acting with great boldness towards you. I have great pride in you. I am filled with comfort. In all our affliction, I am overflowing with joy." When Paul gave that third letter, that tearful letter to Titus, and he had Titus deliver it to the church of Corinth. He was taking a measured risk. This church was already in meltdown mode, and the letter, as we just heard, pushed and pulled people into distinct groups. Paul worried for Titus, and he worried that this letter might be the final undoing of that church in Corinth, which, you know, was kind of in bad shape because of his last visit. So when Titus did not return as they had planned and meet up with Paul in Troas, Paul began to experience a little bit of anxiety. He worried that maybe something was happening that was irreparable in the church, or maybe they had even hurt Titus in some sort of way. But eventually, Paul can't wait in Troas any longer, and so he goes up and over into Macedonia, and it's at that point where he runs into or he meets Titus, and he hears from Titus the effect of his tearful letter. Paul was at last comforted despite the trials he was facing in Macedonia. He describes in verses 5, 6, and 7, "For even when we came into Macedonia, our bodies had no rest. We were afflicted at every turn, fighting without and fear within. But God, who comforts the downcast, comforted us by the coming of Titus, and not only by his coming, but also by the comfort with which he was comforted by you, as he told us of your longing, your mourning, your zeal, so that I rejoiced still the more." Here, Paul distinguishes the audience he is addressing. Whereas 2 Corinthians has a little bit for the first group, the second group, and the third group, this is where Paul makes clear that, hey, for this part right here, I am really speaking to those whose hearts have been changed, for those who are in that third group. But what exactly happened here? What caused such a significant number in the church to be loyal to Paul once again? Was it a well-written note from Paul? Did he play the pity card so that people would feel sorry for him? Well, we actually don't know exactly what he said, but we are clearly told the result that it had. It grieved them. These people that had been in open rebellion to Paul and his message, they saw their shortcomings. They saw their failures and their sin in relation to Paul and his message of Christ. But the effect did not end there. Verses 8, 9, and 10. "For even if I made you grieve with my letter, I do not regret it, though I did regret it. For I see that the letter grieved you, though only for a while. As it is, I rejoice, not because you were grieved, but because you were grieved into repenting. For you felt a godly grief, so that you suffered no loss through us. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death." And so those two ideas, worldly grief and godly grief, are what we are going to think deeply through today. Paul, much like Paul tends to do, he coins those terms here, and they aren't found elsewhere in the Word of God, so you can't just word search them and find out what exactly they mean. Although the term is not seen, the effect of godly grief or worldly grief are seen time and time again throughout the Word of God. Just look at the difference between the failures of King David to one hand and King Saul to the other. Both did horrendous things, but when David fell, upon being convicted by Nathan, he repented to God. Saul, on the other hand, when he fell, his first instinct was, I need to go do something great for God. I need to go build this altar. I need to have all these great sacrifices. I need to do something that wins his favor once more. Or look at Peter and Judas. Both of them did terrible things in those final days of Jesus to denounce him, to betray him. Peter, although, runs back into the arms of Jesus, and Judas decides to go about his own form of winning God's favor or taking care of his shame. Failure causes some to return to God, while it causes others to retreat from God. You, depending on the translation you may be reading, are going to see this as godly sorrow, worldly sorrow, or godly sadness, worldly sadness, or even godly grief in some of the translations. I will kind of use those terms interchangeably, sadness, grief, sorrow, but I'll probably favor sorrow because I think it's a helpful one. The first thing Paul desires to communicate through this godly sorrow is that it is a sorrow that God uses. The second thing Paul means to communicate by this contrast is a contrast between what he calls worldly sorrow and godly sorrow. And so this is why Paul wrote the letter that confronted them like it did. Paul had confidence that the sorrow produced by his letter, despite him coming down hard on their sin, he thought that the sorrow it produced could be used by God. Paul sees godly sorrow as a good thing. Sorrow is in many ways the emotional sibling of physical pain. Pain is God's way for our bodies to tell us that something is wrong. If you have ever worn the wrong pair of ill-fitting shoes on a run or a hike, you may have experienced a hot spot that turned into a blister. And if you persisted in wearing them, that blister could be infected or become an open sore. So the cycle of pain goes, warning us that the shoes we have are wrong for us. Obviously, the proper response is change. Change your shoes, increase the number of socks you wear, do something to stop the physical pain and damage being done to your foot. Physical pain is often visible and easy to remedy. With emotional sorrow, however, our conscience, instructed by God's word or upon hearing it, is telling us that something isn't right. Those lies that we persist in telling twinge our hearts as they flow from our lips. The tone we use with our spouses leaves us feeling dark and heavy. The way we treated someone in need made us feel guilty. The images we lust over in private leave us with a feeling of filth. All these things, consciously or unconsciously, leave us feeling sorrowful. We are made uncomfortable by the feeling of guilt when the Word of God shows us that something we've done is sin and thus has brought reproach upon God's name and His work within us. So like physical pain, sorrow is not a bad thing, but it's actually an indicator of something bad within us or bad that we are doing. And so unfortunately, sometimes we just try to get rid of that pain or that sorrow. We pop a few Advil and we just ignore what is happening. Or we maybe turn to alcohol or some sort of other idol that we've built up within our lives and we expect that idol to take away that sorrow that we are feeling. But Paul was just not aiming for them to feel that guilt and that sorrow. He wanted for the Corinthians what comes next, and that is repentance. Because godly sorrow produces repentance, also known as change, a turning from one's way. This is an easy conclusion to reach most of the time with physical pain. You feel it, and so you no longer do that. Makes sense, right? But obviously, there are some good forms of pain, such as soreness from maybe working out. But with pain, most of the time, you know, such as stubbing your toe, you do that on the table leg, you stop walking so close to the table leg, so you stop stubbing your toe. If grabbing that hot pan off the stove burns your hand, stop. You know, use a glove. If your doctor tells you the pain in your joints is from carrying too much weight, stop. Get rid of some excess weight. Physical pain just has kind of clear indicators of whatever response should be. One does not need to be an expert to understand the obvious change needed for most physical pain in our lives. Paul knew that the Corinthians' realization that they had been wrong towards him and God, that they would experience sorrow. And Paul rejoiced when he heard from Titus that the sorrow they had experienced had produced a heart change within them, because that meant they had experienced godly sorrow, not worldly sorrow, which produces death. Death for Paul is fundamentally an alienation from God that keeps us and everyone in the throes of sin and blinded to the glory and the goodness of God. And for unbelievers, this extends into eternity. When we grieve in the face of our sin, as the world tells us to, it slowly leads to death in all areas of life. The world doesn't know how to handle sin. It doesn't want to acknowledge sin, nor does it want to feel, nor does it want to feel the conscience-driven sorrow. Just look at the way our society has tried to redefine what sin is and how to redefine how we should deal with the sorrow that comes from that sin. Maybe as we think about lust, our society has tried to make lust a commonplace thing. It fills our media, and it's something that isn't portrayed as bad, but rather something that just exemplifies a beauty. Or maybe the way we look at pride, you know, pride is rampant on social media. People talking about this thing they did or that thing they accomplished. And so our culture tries to redefine sin to make it more acceptable. That way the sorrow that comes from encroaching upon that sin isn't as severe. And so here are some ways that worldly sorrow brings death and our usual response within it. It brings emotional death. This death comes within our emotional life. Our conscience, through sorrow, is alerting us that something wrong is wrong, but we decide that we would rather ignore that indicator. Instead of finding hope in God, we seek to numb the sorrow and find our own way to manifest temporary joy or hope for the sin we are in. This emotional death is what we see happening in countless people stuck in the rut of sexual sin. They are forced to fake the love they want to feel with a carnal lust. Instead of manifesting positive emotions such as humility, we rely more on anger and pride to mask our sorrow. Emotional death happens within us. Death from worldly sorrow also comes in our relational life as well. Look what happened between Paul and the Corinthian church. They could not stand the guy continually presenting God's truth in love to them. This was the guy that had seen them go from fallen to a new creation. He had spent a year and a half with them. He had cared for them. He had loved them. But now that that truth was pricking at the sins they so enjoyed, they did not like that. And when we die relationally, we hide our sins and we put on the appropriate facade and we don't let people know who we really are. That can be one response. Or the other response is we let those sins run rampant and we act as if that sorrow, that grief from those sins isn't really there. And that sin running rampant in our lives destroys every single relationship that we have. We pretend like it isn't there. Both of these responses prevent us from enjoying genuine relationship. One, we try to hide who we are. Or two, everyone sees who we are, but we pretend not to care. Relational death happens between us and others. The final death is what comes in our spiritual life. Even if you are a believer, your failure to repent from sin leaves you in sorrow, shame, and guilt. You feel as though you want to earn the grace that you have freely been given. And this is why so many believers, so many good-intentioned brothers and sisters in Christ will respond to great wickedness in this area in life by trying to look like a saint over here in this area of life. Or maybe they just retreat entirely. They give up believing that they are desired by God. They fall out of the church. They fall out of the community. And they think that their sin somehow, this great sorrow that they are in because of it, is somehow preventing them from approaching God. Spiritual death like that happens between us and God. Worldly sorrow is a tragedy for everyone, but especially so for the believer. It is a complete denial of the redemption that has occurred for us in Christ in all aspects of our life, emotionally, relationally, spiritually. And when we revert back to the world's method of dealing with grief, we are saying to God, "Let me deal with my own sin and its effects. You hold off." And unlike the death that is found in its worldly counterpart, godly sorrow is a good thing that produces repentance and leads to salvation. Salvation can be a tricky word when you look across the corpus of the Bible. It's used in different ways at different times, especially if you start looking into deeper theology. But Paul was not saying to these believers in Corinth that they were somehow justified by this instance of repentance. He was saying that they were sanctified by it. So although it would look similar, if someone became convicted of their sin and they repented because of the sorrow that they were in and they experienced that salvation, that happens like that as far as justification goes. But Paul is talking to believers here. And so it happens in a similar way in which we are convicted of our sin, we feel the grief come upon us because of it, and we repent just like we once first did to God. And what this does is it made these Corinthians more like Jesus. And that's what it does for us. When we repent, when we tear a sin that's been leeching off us out of our life, it makes us more like Jesus. Verse 11 says, "For I see what earnestness this godly grief has produced within you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. At every point along the way, you proved yourselves innocent in the matter. So although I wrote to you, it was not for the sake of the one who did the wrong, nor for the sake of the one who suffered the wrong, but in order that your earnestness for us might be revealed to you in the sight of God." When we correctly respond to sins with godly sorrow, producing repentance, we are taking part of the Spirit's renewal within us. As you can imagine, this is why Paul, despite the less than favorable circumstances and the persecution he was under while in Macedonia, that when he heard from Titus what the response of these Corinthians had been, he felt joy. Paul explains in verse 12 that his convicting of them was done to reveal to them what was in their hearts. Paul wrote this third letter to the church of Corinth so that the sin they were steeping in could be made clear by the resulting sorrow they experienced when confronted. It worked. They realized that the rejection of Paul and his message of the gospel was wrong. They repented. They began to embrace Paul. In verse 11, Paul rattles off seven different ways that they have been changed. Their earnestness, their eagerness, their indignation, their fear, their longing, their zeal, their desire for justice. This repentance and grief was used to further transform them into the likeness of Jesus. It saved them. What a great story, right? Who knew that something as hard as sorrow could be used for God's good? The next obvious question is, why don't we try to bring about godly sorrow more often? I mean, we are hearing the Word of God sometimes daily, hopefully at least weekly. We are within some sort of community weekly, if not even daily. Well, why don't you? In all honesty, and this goes for myself as well, we don't like going through sorrow. And we don't like causing others to go through sorrow as well. But that is because we have reverted to thinking of sorrow as something worldly, something that we as Christians should not experience, when in fact we need to view sorrow like Paul does, as a gift from God that alerts us that something is wrong. That when viewed through the lens of the gospel, we see sorrow over sin as something that Christ has provided a way out of for us. In our sorrow, we know that we are forgiven and that we have the power to change by His Spirit in us, which leads to fullness of life, salvation. So what you and what we walk away from today, I hope, is twofold. One, we need to be ready to receive truth that creates godly sorrow. We need to be ready to receive it. As I said earlier, exposure to truth that yields no positive change is a frightening thing. You should not ever take lightly the word of God or the good counsel of a brother or sister in Christ. If you are avoiding this sorrow in the face of sin by allowing a callus to build up on your conscience, or you're just trying to numb those feelings altogether, make this known. Nothing softens a hardened heart like a little bit of public humility in the form of repentance. Speak with someone you trust, and if you don't have anyone that you can trust like that, nothing builds trust like sharing something deep and vulnerable. The only way Titus was able to report back to Paul with the news that he had was because the people of Corinth first spoke to Titus and reported to him that they were wrong and they wanted to change. So how can we tell the difference between this godly sorrow and this worldly sorrow within our life? They both bring that feeling of grief and that feeling of sadness. Well, I think we see within this passage that godly sorrow passes. It is there for a while. You feel the effect of the sin on your spirit, but upon repenting, you find that goodness, that salvation, that joy. And so godly sorrow will linger for a while, but then it will pass. And when it does pass, the sin does not remain. You have repented from it. You have changed your ways and gone the other. That doesn't happen with worldly sorrow. It is a continual falling back into the same pit time and time again. And the final thing that we know the difference between godly sorrow and worldly sorrow is that the community of Christ agrees with us. They see our repentance. They see the change that has happened within us, and it brings joy. And that is why that aspect of community, of the body of Christ, is so crucial for this next point of application. Since we are all priests in Christ's kingdom, we need to give truth that creates godly sorrow. Many personal faiths have been saved because someone dared break social norms to confront a brother or sister in sin. Paul knew that the best thing for the church and the people within it was for them to repent of their sin, but this meant that they had to become aware of it. They had to be confronted in it. Too often we watch other believers fall away after having struggled under the weight of their sorrow. We just hope that, oh, maybe the pastor will go and talk to that person, or maybe that other person who's probably a little bit closer relationally will go and do that. Paul, I don't know how many miles he was separated by them, but Paul wrote a letter and then, you know, sent someone all the way across Greece to do this. He didn't rely upon someone else in that church. He saw the issue and he decided to do something about it. Our experience with godly sorrow and the freedom that follows it should be an encouragement to help others escape. This may be something that we are entirely unfamiliar with or uncomfortable with. So here are some pointers from Paul that we see. Tell them about the place they have in your heart. When you approach someone who you believe to be in sin, tell them how much you love and you care for them. Maybe tell them about the sin that you have escaped from in your own life as well. Be honest with them. Tell them they are in your heart, just like Paul told these Corinthians that. Remind them of the place they have in God's heart. Remind them of the gospel. Preach the gospel to them. If this is a believer, they should know the hope they have in Him, the change that has come upon them in their life. Remind them of the place they have in God's heart. And then lastly, at that point, address the issue you think is in their heart. Because only after seeing your heart and being reminded of God's heart will they be a little more comfortable about opening up their own heart and seeing what wrong is in there. Because if they know that your heart is sincere, and if they know that God's heart is sincere, then the last place for them to look is for in their own heart. This is not an automatic fix, sadly. I mean, we saw a threefold division within the Church of Corinth upon the delivery of that sorrowful letter. People may still choose the way of the world over the way of God, but if they do repent, joy spreads to all. The passage is littered with Paul referencing the joy and the comfort that has spread to him, to Titus, to those believers in Corinth, because of their repentance. So, if our avoidance of sorrow while in Christ is because we see it as antithetical to the joy we are promised in Him, then we need to remember that godly sorrow that produces repentance leads to joyous salvation. And that far exceeds anything this world can drum up to deal with sorrow. Will you pray with me? Lord, I hope as these words fell that people were searching their hearts and searching their lives for things that are causing sorrow within their own life. And I hope they do that for a while before they begin to think about the things they are seeing in other people's lives. Lord, may we with care and with love and with exposed hearts go about bringing this godly sorrow. And Lord, may we just hand it over to you as we do. Amen.